JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for April the 29th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded lower against all the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian morning Wednesday. It lost the most ground against SEC, Kiwi, NOK and Aussie in that order, while it underperformed the least versus Yen, the Pound, the Swiss Franc and the Euro. Now, the weakening of the dollar and the strengthening of the commodity-linked currencies suggest that risk appetite may have remained supported for another day. Indeed, major EU indices were a sea of green, you can see the graph here, aided by a rally in banking shares following a 40% jump in UBS quarter one earnings and a 4.2% in Spain's Santander. It seems that expectations have fallen so much due to the uncertainty surrounding the coronavirus that anything less bad than anticipated is seen as positive. The optimism due to several economies starting to loosen restrictive measures may have also helped. Wall Street indices traded in the red, pulled by slides in technology stocks. That said, it seems that flows were diverted into economically sensitive value stocks as they have the potential to benefit more by the easing of lockdown measures. Risk appetite rebounded again during the Asian session today. Although Hong Kong's Hang Seng closed virtually unchanged, China's Shanghai Composite and South Korea's KOSPI gained 0.23 and 0.73% respectively. Japanese markets were closed due to a holiday in Japan. Now back to the currencies. The Swedish krona was the main gainer among the G10s, coming under strong buying interest after the Riksbank decided to continue its purchases of government and mortgage bonds up to the end of September 2020 and to leave the repo rate unchanged at 0%. Although officials noted that they cannot rule out the possibility of interest rates being cut at a later date, they added that it was not deemed justified at this point to try to increase demand by a cut when the economic downturn is due to impose restrictions. The market reaction suggests that expectations that there may have been expectations for more stimulus today, but remember yesterday we noted that this may not be the case, as following only a small downtick in the core CPIF rate, officials may prefer to stand pat and wait to see whether the already adopted measures are having the desired effects. Now, the Aussie was also among the main gainers, perhaps gaining extra ground after Australia's better-than-expected CPIs for the first quarter. The headline rate moved to 2.2% year-over-year from 1.8%, above the lower end of the RBA's target range, while the trimmed mean and weighted mean CPIs accelerated more than anticipated to 1.8% and 1.7% from 1.6% and 1.3% respectively. When they last met, Australian policymakers left monetary policy unchanged and offered some details with regards to their QE program. They noted that they will do what is necessary to achieve a three-year yield target of 0.25%, with the target expected to remain in place until progress is being made towards the goals for full employment and inflation. However, they added that if conditions continue to improve, it is likely that smaller and less frequent purchases of government bonds will be required. Now, after saying that interest rates have reached their effective lower bound at their prior meeting, the aforementioned points suggest that there is very little chance of expanding their QE program. On the contrary, they could soon scale it back if the spreading of the coronavirus continues to level off, and accelerating inflation is likely to make their work easier. Now, as for today, the spotlight is likely to turn to the FOMC decision as well as to the first estimate of the US GDP for the first quarter. This would be the first ordinary meeting since January, after which the committee decided to proceed with a number of stimulative measures, including cutting rates to the 0.025% range and unlimited amounts of QE purchases to support the US economy from the coronavirus damages. On March the 26th, Fed Chair Powell highlighted that the Fed is not going to run out of ammunition in its attempt to stimulate the economy, but since then they announced programs considered as a never-seen-before intervention into the US economy. The committee announced that it will purchase corporate bonds, backstop direct loans to companies, and that it will initiate a program to provide credit to small and medium-sized businesses. They also announced that they will purchase unlimited amounts of treasuries and agency market-backed securities in order to allow proper functioning of the US debt market. Now, with the Fed never been in favor of the negative rates regime, you can also see that the market does not believe that the Fed will cut rates into negative waters. All these measures make us believe that now there is little easing ammunition in the chamber, and thus policymakers may prefer to stand pat for now and wait for a while to see whether the already adopted measures are having the desired effect on the economy. However, market participants may be sitting on the edge of their seats in anticipation of clues as to how long interest rates could stay near zero and whether the Fed is willing to do more in the not too distant future in order to fight the virus. That said, with the situation easing somewhat lately, we don't expect them to appear too much concerned. However, we don't expect them to serve too much optimism either, as the element of uncertainty remains. No one can guarantee that the virus will not start spreading fast again after the restrictions start to ease. Thus, they are unlikely to proceed with any language pointing to when interest rates may start being lifted, while they could still signal readiness to do more, but only if the situation worsens again. Such an outcome may result in a somewhat higher dollar, but the currency's fate may also depend on the first estimate of the US GDP for the first quarter due out ahead of the Fed decision. Expectations are for a 4% quarter-over-quarter seasonally adjusted rate contraction after a 2.1% expansion in the last 3 months of 2019. A shrinking economy would be a surprise to no one, given that the fast spreading of the coronavirus in the US during the last month of the quarter. That said, it would be interesting to see how deep the wounds have been. According to the Atlanta GDP Now and the New York Nowcast models, the economy contracted only 0.3% and 0.4% respectively, something that shifts the risks of the official forecast to the upside. A better-than-expected print may give an initial boost to the dollar before the FOMC decision. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning, Germany's preliminary CPIs for April are coming out. Both the CPI and the HICP rates are forecast to have slid notably to 0.5% and 0.6% year-over-year, respectively, from 1.4% and 1.3%. This would raise speculation that the headline rate of the Eurozone as a whole due out tomorrow may follow suit. From the US, apart from the FOMC decision and the GDP data, we also get pending home sales for March and the Energy Information Administration weekly report on crude oil inventories. Pending home sales are expected to have slid 10% after rising 2.4% in February, while the Energy Information Administration report is expected to reveal a 10.619 million inventory increase following a 15.022 million. As for tonight, during the Asian session Thursday, we get Japan's preliminary industrial production and retail sales, both for March. Industrial production is anticipated to have declined 5.2% month over month after sliding 0.3% in February, while retail sales are forecast to have fallen 4.7% after rising 1.6%. China's official PMIs for April are also coming out, but no forecast is currently available. Following the slowdown and the stabilization of the coronavirus in China since March, we wouldn't be surprised if the PMIs reveal another month of expansion in both the manufacturing and services sectors. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning more about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.